Amen.
Cool. This being an Adventist
church, I thought I'd take a couple of questions and tell you how I became a Seventh-day Adventist, because some people are going to sneak in the door a little late, and then Pastor will open with a prayer. Okay? Sound good?
Yeah.
All right. Start to think about a couple questions you'd like to ask me. Okay, but here's how I became a Seventh-day Adventist. I was working late. Am I on?
Yeah.
Okay. It sounds so gentle. Usually, you know, I hear feedback and such. Steve's doing a great job. Actually, it's his son. Okay. But anyway, my wife to be, my brother-in-law didn't want anybody to meet his sister. He didn't trust boys around his sister. And what he would do is if anybody wanted to date her, he would threaten them with violence at PUC. And so finally, and he had climbing buddies who would also threaten anybody wanted to ask her out. The climbing buddies wanted to ask her out, but they made a pact that they wouldn't because they thought it would ruin their friendship. And so they're still friends today, and Cindy's still their friend. Anyway, long story short, she wanted to see the Cousteau office. He didn't want her to meet any Cousteau divers because he thought one of them might run off with his sister. He was right to worry. So he came in on a weeknight, like on a Wednesday at 9:30 at night, to show her the office, and I was there in the basement working. And Cindy and I met, and it was literally love at first sight for both of us. She later admitted that. It took a long time. I was going to ask her. I wanted to ask her out, but her brother was hovering, but he had to go get a dive bag, and he ran to get it, and I quickly asked her out. And as she says, okay, he comes running back, and he goes, okay, what? And she says, Bruce, come on, I'm 29 years old. Leave me alone. For our first date, I'm an incurable romantic, incurable. For our first date, I met Cindy with 101 long-stem red roses. Oh, no, this isn't working. I'm sorry. Ladies, there are men in here that need training, okay? So a verbal reaction would be nice, okay? For our second date, I met her with 201 long-stem red roses. Wow. Now, guys, I got him on sale. There's the guy I like, the Cousteau Society. He gave me 101 for 20, and he gave me 201 for $22. Isn't that great? Okay. All right. So for our third date, I met her with a single giant sunflower. Single giant. Ladies, I met her with a single giant. Okay. The sunflower and I were in. I've told you, I've been incurable romantic. The sunflower and I were in Kahului, Maui. I invited her to join a Cousteau expedition to be with humpback whales. And for work, I had her skipper our support vessel. And the Frenchmen were mortified. They go, never, never a woman would drive the boat in France. Never we would do this. And the cinematographer, on the third day of the expedition, he climbed the flying bridge after saying that. And he said, Cindy, mon capitaine Cindy, because she thought she was doing a great job. And she looked at him and she said, as your skipper, acknowledged skipper, I order you to get below decks and make me a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and make sure you use whole wheat. And he did it. For our fourth date, she took me to Paradise, California. My mother-in-law was the church secretary. My father-in-law was a retired pastor. And I went into a Seventh-day Adventist church for the first time. And what really captured my attention is that the church was focused on kids and on family. And then they had a Sabbath commitment. And I was just wowed. And on December 26, 1992, our four-month-old baby girl was dedicated, and I was baptized at the church. Okay? Now, the reason why I waited till then to get baptized and to join the church is I had to leave the Cousteau Society because it's a Saturday. When you're on expedition, you work 7 days a week. If a whale surfaces right there, you have to go film it. I had to lead it. And so I couldn't make a Sabbath commitment until I left the Cousteau Society. Now, people ask me about Jean-Michel and Captain Cousteau. When I left the Cousteau Society, they didn't want me to go. Now, I'm only going to share this. I'm not sharing this for an egotistical reason. I'm only sharing it to show you the things that were the opportunities I had. They offered me the CEO position, Cousteau, United States, USA, to stay. Now, I mean, just for the United States. The main one, is in France, okay? I said, no, I want to do this. The National Geographic Society said, you know what? You have spent 2.5 years leading expeditions diving with great white sharks. We have an expedition going to dive with great white sharks. Would you like to lead it? National Geographic. And I'm going, no, I want to be a lay youth minister. This is my commitment. And I'm going to prove to you tonight that I'm having more adventure as a lay youth minister in the Seventh-day Adventist Church than when I was chief diver for Jacques Cousteau. Yeah, isn't that amazing? I'm going to prove that. I'm going to prove that beyond the shadow of a doubt that this is what's going on in my life right now. Okay? So now, who would like to ask me a couple questions before we open with prayer? Yes?
Does your past less desirable history, does it inhibit you in any way for traveling, or does it interfere a little bit with it?
I can't go to Canada. Okay. They don't let anybody with a felony into the country.
Oh, okay.
And I actually filed the paperwork for what they call a rehabilitation permit, but I never responded to it. They just took my money. Yeah. So I've been to Canada to speak, but now with everything being more secure, I wouldn't try to go across the border again without. And by the way, Bush had a felony for a DUI. And they had to look at that before he went into Canada. It was quite interesting. You know, President Bush, Junior. Okay, when I first got out, I had my own inhibitions about it, but, you know, I'm doing the Lord's work. And I'll take that a step further. People will ask me, do you regret what happened? Sure, I regret what happened, but God had a plan. And he's taking my mistakes and turning them to good work. Okay, yes.
Expeditions.
Yeah, he lost his son Philippe. They had a seaplane, and they thought he would kill himself in the plane. But what happened is somebody left the hatch open on one of the pontoons, and so when he landed, he got these pontoon underwater, and enough water got into it that it pulled it down, and the propeller went into the water, and then a blade broke off, and it killed Philippe, and then it cut the seat harness free of the cameraman sitting next to him and saved his life. And the Cousteau Society still exists. Jean-Michel Cousteau himself is no longer a part of it. And so he started his own foundation called Ocean Futures. Okay, there's a question waiting to be asked, and I haven't heard it yet.
Well, if it exists, where is it?
Huh?
Cousteau Society, I don't see it.
It's still there. It's suffering greatly. Yeah. And so I was waiting for that question. Remember, I have a lot of respect for Captain Cousteau. I have a lot of respect for Jean-Michel Cousteau. When Jean-Michel's mother died, we called her the shepherdess. When she died, the French have a different attitude about mistresses. They think that having a mistress can be healthy. And he had a mistress, Captain Cousteau had a mistress for 20-something years. And the real Cousteau, Madame Cousteau, passed away, Jacques Cousteau introduced him to his stepmother and to his stepbrother and stepsister, who were teenagers. And the new Madame Cousteau wanted Jean-Michel out of the Cousteau Society. And she did things with the board, and she drove him from the Cousteau Society. And when Captain Cousteau got sick with pneumonia and was in the hospital, Jean-Michel snuck in to see his dad, and she found out about it, and she moved him to a new hospital. She put a silence on it that nobody could talk about it, nobody could visit him, and he was in that hospital for a month, and he died, and nobody knew it until he died. No flowers, no nothing could go into that room. She completely isolated him. And and I share that because look what happens when people don't do family values. Look what happens. His whole legacy is dying. And the Cousteau Society, unless one of the stepchildren step forward and bring it forward, it will eventually disappear. And that's a tragedy. And this is why I push family values, family values, family values. When you get married, I tell my kids this. I used to tell all the time. They've heard it so much now, they've heard enough of it. But I say that Mom and I are never going to get a divorce. And she reiterates that. We are married for life, and I will always be with you unless I get run over by a truck, and that won't be my fault. Okay, we need a pastor for prayer.
On that note, I'm praying. Okay. Join me in prayer. Your gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing of the Sabbath day. We thank you for the time that Brother Stephen has spent with us, and we just ask now for your continued blessing and guidance of the Holy Spirit as we wrap up his visit with us. Give us listening hearts and listening minds that we might understand the message he has for us from you, and that our walk with you would be strengthened, and that we'd be ready to see Jesus when he comes in the clouds. This is my prayer in his name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, we are ready. And I'm going to start off with, we'll be doing the video almost immediately. In fact, we'll do the video, but let me define it before I start the video. Okay, I showed this last night. I'm going to try to, so some people here have seen it, but it's so much fun. I think that you will enjoy it. It's when I accidentally jumped in the water with the great white shark. And I'll share something kind of cute. I'm going to give you an insight into my wife, Cindy, okay? Is I had gotten out of prison, and when we're getting seriously dating, on our very first date, I told her my story so she knew who she was dating. And she listened to every word of it, and when I was done, she said, I really wanted to hear how you said that, because my brother already told me all about it. She said, I also shouldn't date you because you're a next felon. But she said, I already knew. And so we were going to get married, and I had saved $10,000. I've just been a couple years out of prison, and I've saved $10,000. I'm so excited about it. And Cindy and I are going to get married, and she says, you know, I don't want to be a burden on my mom and my stepfather, and so I want us to pay for the wedding. And she's going to college, and she has no money. Okay, so what money are we talking about? And I'm so careful saving money. And so I came up with an idea to save my money, okay? I approached Jean-Michel, and I said, Jean-Michel, my wife Cindy's a skydiver. What if she joined the expedition, if she skydived into the expedition, and when her parachute opened up, it had the Cousteau logo on it, and she lands in the water, and then the captain of the ship could marry us, and you could put it in the documentary. And Jean-Michel says, that's a good idea, let's do it. And so I told Cindy, and Cindy goes, oh, that's wonderful. So she says, so now we're going to pay for my parents to fly over, because they'd be a part of this, and I still want my wedding at the church that they were married in. And I'm thinking, now I have no money. And so I said, oh, honey, we can't, you have to choose one or the other. And she says, okay, well, we'll get married where my family can come. And I should shoot myself in the head. Wouldn't that have been terrific if I had actually done that? Yeah. You know, and I told you, I was an incurable romantic. Anyway, there it is. So, diving with the great white sharks. The shark, I want you to notice how long it is. It's 17 and a half feet long. Judge it by my height. And the plastic cylinder that I'm going to be getting in and out of is only 3/16 of an inch thick. Okay? So, here we go. Diving. Oh, and what you don't know, so most of you do, is when I was standing on the back of the boat and I'm getting ready to jump in the water because the cage is too tall to get into on the boat. So as I'm getting ready to jump into the water and swim down to the cage, I didn't know that there was a shark under the boat. Now, you may wonder, why would I not know there was a shark under the boat? I should tell you a little bit more. We were chumming. Chumming means to attract fish by throwing blood and guts in the water. And Jean-Michel came up to me. And he, after, by doing this, and whenever we would show the film, he would always call me up. And he says, I want to introduce you to my chum. but anyway, this one day, we had 10 great white sharks at the back of the ship. It was phenomenal. And Jean-Michel goes, you know, Stephen, we have not filmed you jumping into Ziwata with the sharks, huh? And he says, I think maybe today is a good day. And he says, but the problem is you go to the back of the boat, and you stand there like forever, and you just look. You don't need to do that, because it's boring for the film, huh? What you do is you walk to the back of the boat, and you just jump, and we will watch for the shark for you. And so I go to the back of the boat, and I'm standing there, and I take a look, you know, and I don't see a shark. And so I'm about to jump. I put my flippered foot out. I put my hand on my faceplate. And over here, the French chef comes out to dump some garbage, food garbage, over the side. And he sees a great white shark swimming out from under the boat. We didn't know that one was there. And he goes, he's going to go, regard, recon, which means look, the shark, but in French. He remembers, I don't speak French. So he goes, ah, and I jump. And he remembers the word in English. He goes, shark, and I went splash. And 6 feet away, maybe eight, I saw a 17 and a half foot long great white shark. So hit play. Now watch this closely. I have more information. Oh, but I was ready, huh? What is, okay, root menu. Okay, leave the cursor on the middle part so it goes away.
In designing the plastic cylinder, I hoped to study the reactions of a great white shark to a living human seemingly unprotected in the sea. Throughout the day, the steel cage will serve as an observation platform. Deloire, Stern, and I will take the first watch. For most people, the mystery of the Great White Shark comes to this. Are the rare attacks on humans by design or by mistake? Will it charge a man whose protective shield is nearly invisible in the sea? Chief diver Steve Arrington will act as our human bait. Arrington faces a nerve-wracking assignment. Since the only entry is through a hatch atop the 10-foot-high tube, he must wait until the cylinder is lowered into position, then swim down 6 feet to enter it underwater. From above, the team is deceived by the shark's movements. Eventually convinced it is swimming off, they give the all clear signal, but moments later, the shark will veer back suddenly. Unaware that a great white shark is only a few yards away, Arrington jumps. It is a chilling realization.
When I first got in the cage, it's just like looking through a faceplate. And when you're in a steel cage, you have that security of that steel in front of you. But with this one, it disappears from your visual sense. Your subconscious is not completely convinced there's still a cage there, particularly when there's a great white on the other side staring you in the face. That was probably the most exciting moment.
What occurs in the brain of such a creature, we can never know. Even in the presence of bait and blood, the great white moves not in mindless fury, but in apparent bewilderment. It does not attack. It inspects. It seems a cautious animal trying to comprehend things it has never seen nor smelled before. Halts in midwater to stare at the unfamiliar creature in its midst.
As the shark turned its head from side to side, you could look at the eye and you wonder what's going on there. It was suspended, it was hovering.
See how wide?
When the shark was hugging the cage, that was not a point of fear because the shark was not being aggressive. And I could see into its mouth, I could see light coming in the gill slits. It was like really curious, like, who are you, what are you? It was like being next to a tiger and not having that tiger actually trying to attack you. It was just looking at you, another intelligence, and being very close to it.
Its massive mother.
Cool. Wasn't that cool? I'm going to give you a little bit more of the story, okay? When I jumped into the water with the shark, where were the cameras? They were on the surface filming me jump in, and then they got in their steel cage and they went underwater and filmed it underwater. They didn't get where the underwater shot of the shark and me real close together. And the cinematographer said, Steven, he says, that was so exciting, huh? The shark was right there and you were right here. And I mean, it was exciting, huh? And I said, oh, it was incredible. It's the most exciting moment of my life. He says, good, because I want to film it, huh? I go, how are you going to do that? He says, well, the shark is long, huh? Yeah. He says, and so it takes a while to turn around, huh? And so what I need you to do is I will be in the cage, and when the shark comes in, we will have one of the guys stand in the cage with his hand out of the water. And he'll go, one, or un, deux, trois. En trois, you jump behind the shark. And then you swim into the cage. Is no problem, huh? Okay, I'm going to prove to you right now I'm not as smart as I look. I go, okay. So I stand another swim step, 8 inches above the water. I see the shark swimming by, swims by. I see the hand hit three, kind of hesitate, and I jump. And I swim over the cage, and I get inside. Done. Work. So, at lunch, next day, he said, Steven, he says, you know, the film, the shark was not so big and was too far away. I said, what are you saying? He said, take two. So I'm standing in the back of the boat, and definitely the shark's bigger, and it's right there, and the hand is already on three. And I jumped. And that's the footage you saw. And I swam to my cage, and I went to swim down into it, and the regulator caught between the cage and the tank. And I couldn't get in. I'm swimming, and I can't get in. It felt like 3-4 seconds. I saw it later on film, because my wife saw it with me, and she was beating on me over it. And it was only like half a second. And then I pushed back out and went back down into the cage. And that's what got the shark so excited, that she came over and hugged the cage. And so that's how I got that footage. You know, when I tell you stuff like this, it's really good to have some authority. Because I'm saying some pretty incredible things, right? So you heard this morning I wrote a book. And it's called Extreme. The introduction to the book is written by who? The prosecuting attorney. So when I write about my story, he read it before he wrote what he wrote about me. Jean-Michel Cousteau does a piece in the preface introducing who I am. He read the book before he put it there. So when I tell you these things, the people who were there, who are part of the story, you know, they're putting that up front. So I want you to be aware of that. Okay, let me see. What do I want to go to next? This is going to be diving. I want to show you extra stuff. Because how many of you were there last night? See? Okay, I want to show you some extra stuff. And so what I'm going to show you is I talked about diving with a baby whale, a brand new baby whale. I'm going to show you the video footage of swimming with a of being with a baby whale. It had just been born. It's a 300. When it's first born, it weighed 300 pounds. Yeah. It's amazing to see, you know, this big of an animal, and it's just a baby. And I want you to see how the whales swim. I want you to see how graceful they are swimming underwater.
Immersed in the songs of ardent suitors.
Oh, yeah.
In this dense liquid medium, the whales feel sound waves as well as hear them. Epic arias which may caress as well as carry meaning. Whether to attract a mate or intimidate a competitor, they all sing the same song.
Notice how they swim.
A large escort blows a stream of bubbles. A rising curtain of air that obscures mother and baby. 30 years ago, we knew how to hunt them to near extinction. But how do we assure their safe passage into the 21st century?
Okay, I wanted to stop that. Do you see how they're swimming, they're flying? You know, 90,000 pounds. We're in Hawaii, and we're working with the whales. And I'm in a Zodiac with Jean-Michel Cousteau. And he goes, he sees the whales moving, and he instantly knew what was going on. And he grabbed the microphone, and he goes, Cindy, Captain Cindy. And so my wife is on our support boat, and it's this boat that's like about 30 feet long, and or 36 feet long. And she goes, Cindy. And she goes, Cindy here. And he says, a Yuzu Baleen is coming to you. Shut down your engines. And so she does. And I have no idea what the French word user is. But I know the French word baleen means whale. So I don't know what is happening. And so what it is he's using an English word. It's a term for a whale. It's a cow. And she's in distress. She's being pursued by 14 bulls. And it's the end of the mating season. And they're trying to wear her down. And so she looks for a place to hide. Where do you hide a 45-foot-long whale? Well, she's about 36 feet long. You hide her under a boat. What she does is she'll find a boat, and she'll hide under it. And so this Cindy runs to the side of the boat, and she sees all these whales coming towards her. and she's so excited, and she expects the whale to go under the boat and swim out the other side. Instead, it goes under the boat and stops. And now all the bulls want to get the cow away from the boat. So they're breaching next to her boat, their tails are coming up and slapping, and the boat is rocking side to side. She is being rained upon by whale-induced rain, and she is screaming her lungs out with excitement. As she describes it, you know when you feed koi and you have some dog food and you throw it in the water and it just boils with koi? The water around her boat was boiling, and she was the only person on the boat boiling with whales. It's something she'll never forget. And then the whales, the cow realizes this wasn't such a good place to hide. She flees out towards us. Now I'm sitting in this rubber boat, and I still don't know what a user whale is. And Jean-Michel says, "The user whale, she is coming to us. Quick, everybody into the water." So we tumble in, and we free dive, because the sound of your regulator will drive them away, and take three really deep breaths. And then you swim down, and you swim down about twice to three times deeper than this church is tall. And you bring your cameras up the direction they're coming in, and suddenly we see a whale stampede. They're going by almost 30 miles an hour. If a whale hits you, you'll die. Okay, you'll die. They'll run you over, and they're in a frenzy, and I will point out the cow for you, but I want you to see the speed of the whales as they're coming.
In Hawaii, we witness an urgent ballet of lust. 14 bulls pursuing one elusive female.
See, we can't go up. You're holding your breath. You have to stay underwater. Now, she's curious about who we are. So she does a beautiful vertical U-turn to take a second look. Okay, here she comes, right here. That's her. See,
they
she's
leave
being
a haunting
nuzzled.
Question. With such a desire to reproduce, why, after 30 years of protection, are they still endangered?
Under their world.
Okay, I'm going to skip past this one. Oh, I want to go back. Hang on. I'm going to go faster. Go back faster. 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 Did I show this last night?
Yes.
I did?
Was
that was
it
no?
Curiosity?
Yes.
I did?
Yes.
Well, why didn't you tell me that? Okay, but I want to go back. They'll tell you about it. I have other stuff more that's a bit more exciting. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
If I have something a bit more exciting? Okay. You're going to get the full time out of me. I just want to show you a dolphin. That's cool, right?
Yes.
And a girl. Which would you rather see, a dolphin and a girl or a cave?
Dolphin
and the girl. And you're seeing it backwards. Okay, and right there, I can pause. Okay, there's a dolphin in Fiji. There's a dolphin in the Turks and Caicos Islands named Jojo, who loves people. He thinks we're really, really cool. In fact, I can now do my PowerPoint. Let me go to PowerPoint, and go down to here, and slideshow from current slide. Okay, this is Jojo. Jojo loves people. He'd rather hang out with people than with dolphins. What he loves about us the most are our toys. He loves anything with a propeller. When you're at a boat, and you notice when dolphins are at the bow of the boat riding the wave, not Jojo. He's back with the propeller, really close to it, watching it. He loves propellers. If you're learning to water ski, and he sees you going along right with the hold onto a bar along the side of the boat with your two little fins, he'll sneak up under you and nudge one of the fins to see you do a face plant. Kids go out, sit on anchor buoys. It's a buoy about this big. They'll sit on it, and he'll come at about 30 miles an hour and knock it out from under them. He is a very playful dolphin. He has a dog buddy. The dog will go down to the water's edge and bark at him. He will go swim back and forth and taunt him into the water. If the dog goes in the water trying to bite the dog, the dolphin's just looking for a chance to get under the dog because he will flip him over when he does that. He'll flip him through the air. It's amazing. He's a big dolphin. Anyway, when we went diving with JoJo, it was amazing. And like I say, he loves anything with a propeller he thinks is totally cool. You know, you gave me a remote. See, I mean, here this guy is, and he's just turning a propeller for him. And JoJo thinks that's just like totally, totally cool. He's giving advice. He's squeaking all the time. Here's an underwater little submarine, and see where he gets, where he puts his nose? See how he does that? He's totally cool. Now, JoJo was one day, I didn't see it, but this is the story that's told on the island, and the locals tell it, is that JoJo was at the Club Med Resort, and he's going along the water, and he's letting people pet him. He's letting people pet him as he goes by. And he goes up to this American kid who's standing there, a teenager. And this teenager, he sees the dolphin come up, and he's smoking a cigarette. And they saw him take the cigarette out of his mouth and jam it into the blowhole of the dolphin. Now, a dolphin doesn't know what fire is. And this is a cigarette up the nose. And JoJo ran away, and he didn't come back for 10 days. And the people on the island have a lot of contempt for this boy. What do you think of him? What would be a good term to describe this boy? Bully? You can't stand him?
I can't say the word.
You can't say the word?
Evil.
Yeah. How many people think he's evil? Okay. All right. Now, I'm a writer. I write books for young people. I'm a Christian writer. I wanted to write about the boy. I didn't have a lot of time away from the expedition. And so I went looking for people. They said, who saw this? And they said, well, Sophia did. So I finally find Sophia. No, I didn't see it. My girlfriend saw it. Okay, find the girlfriend. No, I never found anybody who saw the dolphin, saw the event. It was all secondhand information. But I want to write about it. And so I'm going to have to try to recreate what happened. So first of all, I'm asking the pathfinders up here, wherever you're at, I'm asking just the pathfinders this question. I need to answer with the word, okay? Are you paying attention? What are you looking at there? What's going on? I saw that. Oh, he just hit you in the back of the head. I got you in trouble. Okay, yeah. Oh, sorry. Didn't need it. Okay, so are you listening? I got your attention. You have to answer my question. You have to answer my question. You ready? Why would a boy smoke the very first cigarette? What is he trying to be? Just you six. What is he trying to be? Cool. See? She got the answer right. Okay, so she's not in trouble. All right? Cool. Now, is it cool to smoke cigarettes?
No.
What do cigarettes do to you?
Kill you.
They kill you. They age you. They make you prone to disease. They do nothing but bad for you. When you inhale a cigarette, within 7 seconds, the chemicals are going through the brain barrier. Within 11 seconds, the brain is sending reactive chemicals to it. Nicotine is a drug. There's over 200 chemicals involved. What it does to the lungs, ages you on the outside, it ages you on the inside, it causes cancers. There's nothing good about it. But we can agree that this boy wants to be cool. Okay, I think this is an important part. Okay, so he wants to be cool, and so now that he wants to be cool, when you do something cool, you do it in your closet all by yourself, or you do it on the playground in front of everybody? You know, in the classroom, disrupt the classroom. Okay, here's this boy who wants people to notice him. I have to have that supposition. He sees the dolphin swimming up to him. He looks up. Everybody's looking at him. Everybody's looking. Do you think he's going to take a cigarette out of his mouth and jam it right there? I think they would have gone down and beaten him up. The people there, they would have sort of tore him up. I think he wanted to do something cool. I think he took the cigarette out of his mouth and he wanted to hold it over the blowhole as it went by to pretend the dolphin was smoking with him. Mm-hmm. How many of you are willing to maybe think that? Yeah. Okay, so a few, okay, all right, we'll go a little bit further. Who knows how a dolphin sleeps? Do you know? Perfect. They're conscious breathers. They have to surface to breathe. So they sleep with half of their brain at a time. When they sleep, half of the brain will go to sleep. The other eye will stay open, droopy, but it'll stay open. It has to watch for sharks, and they have to surface to breathe. When dolphins are in a pod, they will sleep with one eye looking one way, and half of them be sleeping looking the other way. And it's called a sleeping pod, breathing. And when they take a breath, it's a really big breath. And so if somebody was holding a cigarette over the blowhole of a dolphin, it takes a breath like a Hoover vacuum. What could it have done? Could have sucked the ash, the burning part, off the end of the cigarette. It may not have been an act of an evil, mean kid purposely hurting an animal. It could have been a boy who was making bad choices, and now he makes another one. How many of you are now thinking he's not evil, just maybe a little bit acting stupid? How many feel just acting stupid? How many still think evil? Okay, I got a few, all right? I was waiting for that. How many, now you see, we had some, and it's a school teacher, huh? And a young lady here, somebody in the back. So let me just say this. How many of you have been accused of doing something you didn't do? Raise your hands, mine's up. How many, keep them up, we'll see how many go down. How many of you have been punished for doing something you didn't do? Having said that, okay, hands down. Isn't it wonderful that when we go before God, that Jesus is going to be defending us, not a committee of our peers? Okay? I think heaven is going to be a lot more full than we believe. And I want to tell you something else. There's JoJo who swam away. People do things. Huh? Does that look cool? Huh? Doesn't he look much better? Monkey Maya, Australia. Dolphins come to the beach. Almost 200 of them have come to the beach. And people give them fish. And they come up so that you can pet them. And sometimes a dolphin will actually fall in love with a person, and they will bring you a fish. And you never know who they're going to fall in love with. It could be, you know, it could be the grandmother. It could be the weirdo and the speedo. You don't know. Okay. But if a dolphin gives you a fish, you must be careful. Because there's a predator on this beach. He has a bite that's over 2 feet wide. And if you get a fish, he will go after you. His name is Wally. Isn't he cool? I'm going to go back to this picture. There was a woman who was pregnant. And she would come down to the water to see the dolphins. And she would go out in the water and sit while she was pregnant. And the dolphins would come in and echolocate off her tummy. And then when she gave birth, after the baby was a bit bigger, she came back and she sat in the water. And she held the baby in the same spot, and the dolphins went nuts. They were doing backflips and everything else. These are super, super intelligent animals. And the neatest thing for me with JoJo is I'd swam with him and filming him, and the sun was going down, and he was getting tired. He's at the back of the boat, and he's going to go to sleep. And what he would do is he'd swim around the boat. Since he didn't have a dolphin pod, he'd swim around the boat one way and sleep for 30 minutes, and then he'd swim around the other way and sleep for 30 minutes, and then he's refreshed. And then he wants to play. And if you have a sailboat and he'll swim around it, if you don't come out and play with him, he will get, if you have a tender boat, a little, you know, boat that is on the back, little rowboat, he will take it and drive it against the side of your boat until you come out and play with him. And boat owners don't think he's so cool. But he was right at the back of our boat and he's going to sleep, and I was in the water. And as he's there, I would be very careful not to actually touch him. But this time I put my hand under his pectoral fins and I held him up. And I watched both of his eyes close. And I held him for like 20 minutes until I got too cold to hold him anymore. And that was a real special moment for me because I think he experienced something that he never would have experienced but for doing that. And so I have footage of JoJo the dolphin. And one thing I want to say about this is for those of you who'd like to swim with dolphins, the father of this girl made a commitment in life that he wanted to be an underwater cinematographer. And so he worked everything he could to become a cinematographer. And because he did that, when we needed to bring along, you see, we brought along a 12-year-old girl on the expedition. And the reason why we brought her is, A, we wanted to see how JoJo would react to her. But she also did something else, is that when the JoJo would come up, if he's not amused, he would leave. And so when we swim up and we saw JoJo, we would pull back the throttles to stop the boat, and we'd grab her and throw her over the side of the boat. And she would spin in circles and squeak and squeal, and dolphins love that. And while he was watching her, we would get our gear on, and we would get in the water with JoJo. So here's JoJo the dolphin. And notice how he really loves to swim with anything with a propeller. Take just a second. Almost there. And play.
Short time was Joe.
Cursor.
His behavior shows us that even the lone renegade must follow certain dolphin rules. We find ourselves participating in an impromptu experiment. Christine enters a cave in the reef and waits for Jojo to follow. We suspect he won't swim under anything that blocks his access to the surface. At least every 10 minutes, he must take a breath of air and will not risk being trapped. He waits in obvious agitation, almost scolding such foolishness, then leads her to light and life.
Okay, I'm going to take you to Fiji now, and what I'll do is you may have to, if the music is too loud on the video, I'll kind of talk over it, and I'm going to tell you about Fiji. I remember when I went to Vatavona School, it was going to be sold. We saved two schools. We saved Vatavona School and Nini School. They were both going to disappear, and that was 13 years ago, so think about all the kids, and they want to go through the eighth grade. Think about how many kids that impact, and this has been a wonderful, wonderful thing. And I also told you that we had the opportunity to buy 850 acres for $195,000, which is phenomenal. The other part about that is in Fiji, under the British Empire, part of the British Empire, they took land and they sold it. And when they became their own Commonwealth, their declaration of independence and for their country, their constitution. They said that no land will ever be sold again. The only land that can be sold is land that has already been sold. The rest of the land will belong to the people forever, and it will never be sold to people. And so there's only 7% of the property in Fiji can be bought and sold. And so when we bought the 850 acres, we bought it from a private individual. Now the other thing is whatever the asking price is for a piece of property, the Fiji government has first right of refusal to buy it. Do you think they're interested in buying 850 acres for $195,000? They chose not to because they wanted to support our efforts. This is really important for us to be a nonprofit, and we are also a nonprofit foundation in Fiji now. And how's that important? Well, we don't have to pay the 44.5% importation VAT tax. So that's, you know, as we bring stuff in. So anyway, this is Fiji. I know. Okay, go ahead and pause it if you... I'm the pause guy. Okay, well, this is the school. This is Vatavona School. Our property is right next door. This is our property here. In fact, let me actually pause it there if I can be fast enough. Okay, when I say 850 acres, there's the school. We own the adjoining property. It goes like this. Now, this is the entire property. See how it goes all the way out here? And then it comes back, and look at all that shoreline. This is where the resort was for the property, and the resort owners are the one who sold it to us. And when Tom and Marta Tuma bought the property, they paid for it, but it had to go to the Dream Machine Foundation because we were a nonprofit in Fiji, and they wanted to sell it to us, and the government wanted it sold to us. But it took a long time, but we got permission to transfer property to Tom and Marta, and as a gift to us for doing that, they gave us free this piece of property right here. Right here. See the size of that? That's 100 acres. Okay? And I'll show you more about that in just a second. I'm going to show you something as we come up. Okay, let me pause it again. Okay, see this right here? You see how small that is? Okay, that's our dormitory. It'll sleep about 40 people. There it is, when it was first constructed. And you know what I want to do here? I want to build a Swiss Family Robinson youth camp. I do. I want to put houses in trees. As an ex-felon, I have an aversion to cinder block and rebarb. And you can build them in trees for less, and the Fijians would help us. Here comes a Fijian, little guy. Maybe not so little. The Fijians built this with hand tools and missionaries helping. This is the sunrise. 8 miles in that direction. That's our dive boat coming back, or just a boat. 8 miles that direction is the international date line. It's on the water. And for the millennium, we put a boatload of missionaries at sunrise right on the water. They're the first ones to see the... This is the new year. This is mobile mission work that we do. Now, you're going to see some kids. I want to give you an impression of what we do this all the time, is we identify kids that really need help, and we help them. This girl's a clubfoot. She has no feeling in that part of her foot right there, no feeling. That's what she walks on. And so this needed to be corrected, or she would lose that foot. Isn't she a cutie? Now, she's Indian. 44% of the population in Fiji is Indian. This little girl, she broke her leg.
Grew 9 inches.
We brought her to the United States. We did surgery on her, got her healthy. She was going to die. Got her healthy, sent her back to Fiji, and now I'm trying to get her to talk. She's being shy. Here she comes.
They want to see you. Can you say hi to them? Hi.
Isn't she a cutie?
Well, you're not shy anymore. You used to be very shy. I'm glad to see you're not so shy.
His name is Palacio Mombalavo. He's 11 years old. And he fractured his leg last August, falling out of a mango tree, right?
He broke the leg, the bone came out, the family took him to the hospital once, they didn't take him back, gangrene set in, necrosis, they were going to cut the leg off. We flew him to the East Coast, he got surgery on that leg. A year later, I challenged him to outrun every kid at the school. He was going to lose that leg. The government hospital was going to take it off. And look at this, he outruns them all. See the kids cutting across the field? That kid's cheating. But he made it, there's the line, he passed it. This is church building in Fiji. We built 4 churches in 1 company. Don't we make pretty churches? Now here's pretty. The water slides. They're on the next neighboring island. Okay, Fijians have names like Ratu, Nagama, Lala, Balavu. Every other letter in a word is a vowel. They're all natural singers. This is a youth group from my church in Paradise. There's my daughter right there. They just picked from the rainforest. Okay, I need to do a skip real quick. Skip. Okay. When I went to Fiji, I knew how beautiful the diving was. I didn't know how beautiful the diving was 10 miles from our school. It's called Rainbow Reef. It is one of the top 10 dive sites on the planet. This is a cave that you swim down through and come out the other side to Rainbow Reef, to the white wall of Rainbow Reef. This is a world-class dive. And remember, I wanted to take people to Fiji and take them diving and have them do mission work. Notice, see the fish upside down? Gravity goes away underwater. So what I would like to do, I have a lot of ambition, is I would like to take physically challenged kids and teach them, see, upside down. Oh, no, that was right side up. And teach them how to scuba dive. See, physically challenged kids don't get to do athletics with other kids. If they went underwater, two regular kids who don't have challenges and one who's challenged, do you think we'd make a bond for life and something they could always do? And Jean-Michel Cousteau loves this idea. He's also a promoter of it, and he's agreed to be the director of a handicapped diving program at our school, or at our facility if we ever set it up. This is three clownfish upside down. Upside down. There's, yeah. See them? Fiji is world renowned for its corals. There's very little pollution in Fiji. It's a small population, 325 islands, of which 125 are inhabited. I just really wanted to capture some of the beauty of this. That's a fish flatulence. I was wondering how many of you get that one. Now I have a diver blowing bubbles for me so that I can, with a regular, make it a bubble stream under a piece of coral so it's diffused so the bubbles come up, kind of like a curtain. See how beautiful it is in Fiji? Do you see that I'm having more adventure now as a lay youth minister than as chief diver for the Cousteaus? I still get to dive. I get to film underwater. I get to help save lives of kids. We brought 7 to the United States for life-saving surgeries. One we actually sent to India because we got a good price. This is the White Wall. And so I really hope to build this youth camp one day. But what we focus, we're a small foundation, and we focus our resources on saving lives and souls. So when it's the Lord's time, we'll get our youth camp. See why it's called the White Wall? Now, one of the real joys of running the Dream Machine Foundation is other people have gotten interested, and they started their own foundation. And so we have the Tuma Family Foundation, which is called Mission at Natuva Creek. They built the clinic next door. And then we have the Jabez Humanitarian Foundation, which was opened by people who were with the Dream Machine Foundation because they wanted to help the people on Rombie Island inside of Boothia Bay. And then I got a call from a dentist in Laguna, and they were going to Fiji to surf, and they wanted to start a foundation, so we helped them get going as the Fiji Dental and Medical Foundation. And so 4 foundations now are working, and so we're reaching more and more people both in Fiji and in the United States. Now you can see all these corals, and you can see just how beautiful it is. I'll describe some of these to you, give some of them names. I don't know the Latin names, but we call this one a mushroom coral. Wonder why? Yeah. Blushing coral. You touch it and it blushes. Now, I will be taking questions in a while, just so you know. Oh, I got to move that cursor, don't I? Sorry about that. And nobody said anything. Yeah. Did I get it? Where did I move the cursor to? Oh, it's good. Okay. This picture, this clip, I feel is like flying. You see how that's what I love about filming underwater, is you don't need tripods, and you can film from any position. You can get any angle you want. I'm just slowly swimming with the reef. We also do a lot of drift diving where the current carries us, and that'd be perfect for handicapped youth. See how beautiful? Some of the best diving in the world, absolutely. The corals, what they do is they inflate with salt water when the currents are going, and so it exposes the surface area for feeding on things that drift by. And so now, being free in the water, I can come down and I can discover the fish. And then I come down, I capture an angle because I got a missionary diver right in the, there. I got him looking at it. There is something here that if it bites you, you're dead within 4 minutes. Let me know when you see it. Deadly. There it is, yep. Sea snake. This one's huge. He's a 6-footer. I've never seen a 6-footer before. See, now they see him. They're rather reacting. Legs up. Now, they don't want to, they can't eat you. They don't want to bite you. They can be aggressive, but you, it's just how you treat them. So I'm giving them plenty of room, a lot of respect here. I'm not stupid. Okay, getting stupid. I'm 18 inches away. But I had to get the shot. Look at that. Isn't he beautiful? Okay, a foot away. Yeah, 6 inches on the in swing. This is a super wide angle lens. He's looking for crustaceans and fish, little fish, that he can bite and eat. What you get worried about is if they ever swim at you. And it happens just like that. And so now Steve is swimming backwards rather rapidly. Okay, look what's going on here. Hard coral, soft, hard coral, soft coral, clownfish, sea anemone back over here, 3-foot wide clam. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? Clams actually have algae in their skin. Oh, this is a worm, 6 inches long, flatworm. He flies. Ever seen a flying worm? He has eye stalks in the front. He's going to go scare some fish. Watch him when he comes into the cave or a little ledge. Okay, watch. Whoa, what's that? Whoa. Okay, this is a decorator crab. They're so good looking that everything wants to eat them. So he carries a piece of coral to hide under and as a defense. See how good looking he is? What a hunk. See how he would disappear if he stopped? But he keeps on moving. This is the most beautiful coral head I've ever filmed. The tide, there's a surge going back and forth, and it's almost like the reef is breathing as the fish come up and fish go down. This is the backside of it. Doesn't it look like cotton candy? The colors. This is natural light right here. I'm filming with natural light. Now, I encountered some small fish that were being pursued by a predator fish. And the small fish would keep swimming. I would move, and they would suddenly all bolt and go behind me. And you're about to see it. And I'm trying to tell the other divers about it, but you can't talk underwater. And so when you see these fish go by me, they're all actually going to go hide behind me. Watch when I have lights on them. Watch what happens. So here they come. They're running. Look at that color. And they're splitting around me because they're going behind me because there's another fish coming. It's a jack and a tuna are chasing them. And this is a tiny school of fuchsia fish. There's not more than 10,000 of them. About 18 inches to 22 inches long. They're named after Napoleon's horse soldiers because that's the colors they wore. Now, when mission groups, we always want people to have fun. We find different ways to do it. I'm going to show you my wife and my daughters on the water slide. My son, that's my son. He's now 6.5 feet tall. My wife is the true athlete in the family. Let me prove it. Watch. Notice dry hair. There's Shiny, my little daughter, now 20 years old. It's a week old. No. This footage right here is about 10 years. Now, people ask, is there anything with the water slide I should know? Listen, Cindy's going to show you something. Right there, there's a rock. It's amazing that they do this. Shoves him. Look, he shoves him. Oh, they fall, but they just bounce right back up. If I fall, I'd be broken. Want to think about questions you'd like to ask? See, he fell, and he's laughing. And he falls, and he's laughing. My daughter falls, and she's laughing until the bruises hit next morning. And then she hit the same rock Cindy hit. You hear that little ow. People think they're going to lose weight in Fiji. The average weight gain is a couple of pounds a week. It's all vegan, but it's good. And also, they grow these little tiny jalapeno peppers. And the people who never ate one, I talked them into for the film. I said, you got to eat one for the film. So that's my wife, Cindy. This is Barb Zumwalt. First one ever. Making sure they each buy it dead. Okay, what she's doing, we can bring the lights up, please, if you'd like. What she's doing is she was eating sugar to try to get rid of the burn of it. Okay, who'd like to ask me a question or two on Fiji? Remote going right here. Okay, or anything, any questions? Yes. Oh, you know what? I'll repeat their question because we're quiet enough. I think. Can everybody hear her?
Yeah.
Okay. Is that okay with you? He's all for it. Okay.
How deep is the water, Fiji?
Oh, it gets very deep. I mean, it goes down to thousands of feet. We keep people shallow for our diving, but around 60 feet for diving purposes. Another question, and I'm taking advanced divers down to 100. Yes. Well, we had a lot of precautions that we took. I mean, and we had decompression bottles, we had extra cylinders, so we could stay longer, but we were very, very careful because people die going into caves underwater. Yes? The people. See, that's why I wanted to go back to Fiji. What I do is the Fijians get really excited because we've saved the lives of their children. In Fiji, I'll tell you how important this is. In Fiji, if a child is sick, for you to take it to the hospital, it'll cost you one-third, and where we're at, it'll cost you one-third of your monthly income in bus fare. And then you get there, and it's going to cost them more money, and so they don't go to the hospital. They don't go to the hospital until they're really sick. Now, a hospital will have one physician, one in a hospital. And when I was there, when I first went there, they didn't have any ultrasound or anything, and they were giving birth to about 30 babies a month on a sheet of plywood with a 2-inch foam pad. And so we brought a birthing unit in and everything else. I mean, we brought ultrasound, a type of ultrasound in. We did a lot of stuff so that we could help these people. And the ultrasound we brought in was brand new, by the way. But the Fijians believe you go to the government hospital to die. And see, they so often wait so long to go that when they go, they die. And on the bed frames, if there's blood on it, nobody cleans it up. It cleaned up over the weekend or something. And so the services that we provide are truly life-saving. And so when your baby, you can just bring it over to us, not far, and if there's a problem, we'll even send a transportation to bring people. And suddenly a mom can know what's wrong with their child, they can have medication, they can take their child back home, the peace that it gives them. And so they tell us that, oh, what you do for us is phenomenal. Well, what I always do in a church is I'll get a Fijian kid and an American kid. And I'll say, this is what it's all about, because what they teach us about love is equal to the blessing that we get from them. So blessings are always equal. Yes?
What's the deepest you've gone underwater?
206 feet, which you shouldn't do. But we were filming something that was going on at 206 feet. So we went to 206 feet, yes? We've helped over 30,000 people. And now we keep really good records. We had records before that we were keeping, but then when we turned it over to the, we turned our records over to the government. Because remember, as I mentioned this morning, we are the actual representatives of the government when we go in. And you know that when people, when physicians and dentists and nurses ask me, what about liability? We don't charge, we don't accept payment, never have accepted payment. And so it's a humanitarian act, and we are representatives of the government. So to sue us, they have to sue who? They have to sue the government, yes?
So are all the real doctors like mad at you, like
you're taking care of them? Not enough of them. Are the doctors mad at us? One of the dentists was mad at us because he does pain and pull and we do restorative dentistry. But we're 2 hours away by vehicle. So, but he did see less business because of it. But he was a little bit mad, but because he's a Seventh-day Adventist, he had to get over it. The kids, okay, something did happen, which I should share you about the school, Vatavono, is the Fiji mission hasn't had a lot of money, and they finally, the government, they had an opportunity to give the school and get some money for it to the government. So both of our schools were turned over to the government, but what's unique is they're still run as Seventh-day Adventist schools. It still has a Seventh-day Adventist principal running it. And so it's different than what we have here. And now it's gone up in grades. It's gone up into some of the high school grades. So the kids are getting a better education. And there's about 160 kids there. And we still work with the, remember, we work with the government. And so I think it's worked out well. Because when I first went to Fiji, the Fijians, it's about my clan first. My family, my clan, my tribe. And so whenever mission groups would go over to Fiji, they would go to the main island, which is where the mission was. And the second biggest island was not getting mission trips. And they hadn't had a mission trip in, they told me, almost 10 years. And when I first went there, I realized this is where I needed to be. This is where the need is. And so now we have all these mission trips going in there. But also the quiet hour. I've spoken to the church where the quiet hour is at. Now the quiet hour has been going over to Fiji, and other groups are going to Fiji. So it's like I'm the guy at the door of Fiji. I'm the ambassador for the Seventh-day Adventists of Fiji. Come to Fiji. Come to Fiji. Bula vanaka levu. Yes, young man.
What's the official language of
Fijian, but they have to learn to speak English, so they have to learn English at schools. So when we go over on mission trips, it's one of the things that we do is we teach them English as well as mathematics. Yes.
So, if someone would like to join your team, is that possible?
Well, yeah. Can anybody join my team? Yeah. I mean, usually what we try to do is we don't let individuals go over by themselves because we got to make sure that we're doing a good service to the Fijians. And so a mission group goes. So like if this church wanted to put together a mission group, now I'm warning you, you'd be flying from here to Los Angeles. That's an airfare. Airfare to Fiji and then out to our island is $1,620 round trip. Yeah, you're going other side of the planet. And so it's expensive to go, but you would never be the same person again after that. Yes?
Are you still a pilot?
I still have my pilot's license, but I haven't tried to get it renewed. Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. No, you don't want me piloting your plane, I guarantee it. Yes?
On that ship that you were on with those two large stacks, what are those?
Those are sails. Those are mechanical sails, and they're a high lift foil, and they had a stall speed of very, very low, of like 3 miles an hour. You could actually make a plane with that type of a wing that could fly and go about 5 miles an hour and not stall. Wouldn't that be amazing? And the idea is that you could use that to do crop dusting and such and not spread it all over the place. Another question?
Sounds like you're still in contact with Cousteau.
You know what? Well, Jean-Michel Cousteau was best man at my wedding. Okay. And I was just talking to the Don Santee, the guy who hired me just last week. You know, I forgot. We're supposed to be taking an offering, and during the offering, I could take more questions. So let me just say this. I'm taking over a group of 20 kids and about 10 adults, and we're going to be doing medical mission, and we're going to be going out to 5 public schools, and we're going to be evaluating the kids, and this is where we find out the kids who are suffering. And when we go into a community and we're doing the school, well, the whole village comes in, and the people on the out, they come in, and yeah.
How young have kids?
Kindergarten? Well, the kindergarten, oh, did we take over?
Yeah, my
daughter. High school? The kids I'm taking are all, it's all a high school group. So, and you see, and people ask me, they say, Steve, wouldn't it be better off, I mean, with that big airfare, wouldn't it be better off, wait, I'm going to do a prayer for the offering. Wouldn't we be better off just sending the money to Fiji? No, because it's about changing the lives of our kids, right? And so anyway, I need help with this trip because what we have big transportation costs because we're literally going to go to some islands in the middle of our bay, which requires a ferry. And we hire the ferry to go over, and when it arrives, we send patients back to the main clinic. And so we're moving patients to the clinic who need it. And so our transportation cost, local cost in Fiji by itself is going to be over $10,000. And that's just to transport all the patients and to transport the kids. And so these are big fees. Your donation is tax deductible. You would make it to the Dream. If you're making a check, you would make it to the Dream Machine Foundation, like you're dreaming at night. And also, 2 years into our program, remember the Loma Linda sent over a dentist to evaluate us. And then the General Conference sent the Vice President of Accident Management over to evaluate us. And the South Pacific Division sent the assistant to the president over to evaluate us. And so we've been thoroughly evaluated and approved as, you know, a Seventh-day Adventist work. Although Seventh-day Adventist is not in our name because we are an interdenominational foundation. What I mean by that is we're inclusive. I want people to meet my church. And so and the people ask me, can I go to Fiji if I'm not a Christian? Certainly. But you must respect the Sabbath. You must respect that we're Christians. You must have a clause and everything else. And I have to warn you that there's a very serious risk that you're taking. Because when you come back, you may become a Christian. Okay, while you're down there. And we have had baptisms down there of kids. Yes. It's called dreammachinefoundation.com. I started the foundation a long time ago, and .org hadn't come out yet. And then when it did come out, I thought, well, people aren't going to know about .org. They know about .com. So Dream Machine Foundation. And my other web page is drugsbite.com. Okay, let's do a prayer for the offering. Dear Father, Father, this is your offering, and it's to do your work. And we ask, like the bread and the fish, to help it to go so very, very far to change lives, to save souls, and to save children's lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so we can do the foundation, and now I can take more questions. Yes?
When you're talking at elementary school, how much are you able to speak in terms of your religion?
Okay, when I speak in public schools, and I've spoken at over 3,000, if you ask me a leading question that allowed me to share my Christian experience, I would dodge it. And I'll tell you why. Is the reason why I've got to speak in over 3,000 public school assemblies is if I start talking about Christianity, you think somebody's going to complain about it?
Yes.
Absolutely. Satan's busy. Who's going to take the rap? Not me. The people who brought me in, God will, the people who brought me in and the principal of the school. And then what is my chances of going back to that school?
Nil.
And so here's what I do. Like we did it last night, is I go at the end of a program, I say, look, and by the way, I teach Christian values when I'm preaching. That's what I do when I'm speaking in schools. But then I go, hey, if you want to hear more, I'm doing a family program at the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Auburn. And it starts at 7 o'clock, and it's open for everybody. Everybody can come. It's a family program, and it's free. So if you want to know more, I'll be at the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Auburn. And then I'll go, okay, particularly if it's elementary, I'll go, where am I going to be? And some kid will stand up, at the Seventh-day Adventist Church over in Auburn. Did a message just get planted? Okay, I was speaking at a high school up north of us, up north of you, well north. And I'm doing my program, and at the end of it, three boys came up. And they said, oh, we loved your program, da-da-da-da-da. And I said, well, great, thank you. And they said, by the way, are you a Christian? I said, yeah, I'm a lay youth minister. Oh, we knew it. Hey, girls, come here. Come here. Girls come down. He's a lay youth minister. The girls go, we knew it. I go, why are we whispering? They say, oh, it's not cool to be a Christian at this school. Not cool to be a Christian. So for kids to show their faith in a public environment takes courage. And our job is to give them that courage. Okay, I'm almost done with the questions, but I'll take a couple more if you want to ask. Yes?
Do you already have
20
kids who take
the PG? I do. Yeah. Yeah, I have, this group is already full, already going. I will go next July. Okay, again. And I prefer taking kids, because kids are fun. Kids are fun. Okay, and the Fijians love them. Second question for you. They're most of the youth group is coming from the Laguna Niguel Church in Southern California. And then I have friends of mine, you know, who've gone on mission trips before, and they're coming along, physicians and nurses, and one dentist. Yes?
Tell us about your family, your children.
Well, my oldest daughter's 22, and she loves plants and insects, so she's studying to be a PCA, which is a pest control advisor. My youngest daughter, who's 20, she's smart as a whip. She's a 4.0, and she wants to study medical engineering and medical technology. And my son, he's 6 feet tall, and all of his energy is going into his growth. He doesn't know what he wants to be. Okay, but he's still graduate. He hasn't graduated from high school yet. And my wife Cindy is a physical therapy assistant, and she challenges me. Yes. Prayer. No, they're not going to fuss with you. And, you know, they even have some sharks here and there. They're not going to fuss with you. I take kids to Fiji because I don't ever want to lose one. And it's a really safe place to take kids. They're not going to come home with an incurable disease. Okay? All right, I'm going to close with prayer because I need to share what I brought with me to offer. But we need to close this part first. Dear Father, Father, as always, you're in charge, and this is your work. And I ask a special blessing upon the congregation, and that is that for the rest of their lives, every single day, they have the opportunity to do something good for somebody else in your name, so that it always points back to you, and so that we can bring people to the Holy Spirit, to Jesus Christ, and to you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. you want a real quick story?
Yeah.
I was reading in prison after I became a Christian. I read, it wasn't a Seventh-day Adventist publication. I didn't know what a Seventh-day Adventist was. And they just told a story. It was a fictitious story. And so bear with me. This is just a fictitious story, okay? And it's of a man who dies, and he goes to heaven in this story. And an angel meets him, and he takes him on a tour. And they go by this building, and it's a really big, big building. It's like the size of a Costco. And the guy goes to the angel, he says, "What's this building?" And he says, "That's where God keeps gifts not given." He goes, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah." He says, "Do I have any gifts in there?" And he says, "Absolutely." Oh, the guy's so excited, he runs in, and the angel's going, "Wait, wait, wait," but the guy runs in. And he goes in, and imagine shelves of incredibly beautifully wrapped presents. I mean, we're talking about presents wrapped by angels. I mean, can you imagine how beautiful they would be? But there's no labels. Not a label on one of them. Just all these thousands and thousands of beautiful gifts. And he comes out, and he goes to the angel. He says, "I don't know which one's mine, which one's mine." He says, "You don't understand. This is your warehouse. These are gifts that God wanted to give you, but you never asked." And this affected me very, very deeply, and I never understood why. And then at a Christmas with my family, years ago, it hit me. I had bought these wonderful gifts for the kids, and the kids had made things for me that were just phenomenal. And I realized, what is the best thing about a gift? Isn't it giving it to somebody else? What is the most precious gift we could give somebody else? Telling them about Jesus Christ. Introducing them to God. What if, now I don't mean to put a burden on your souls, but what if all of those in there were opportunities to share God with a stranger or somebody, and he didn't do it? It takes courage to share God. It takes courage. But it's how we save lives. It's how we save souls. It's how we make ourselves people of meaning and purpose to our lives. And I'll tell you something. You bring somebody to God, you have a friend for life. Because we need to know this. And I can tell you right now that I have filled a Costco with gifts, not given. I filled one all by myself. I've done it. And there's times when I have the opportunity and I don't. But you know what? There's times now when I do, when I wouldn't have. And I have not yet had a bad experience. I haven't always reached a person, but I haven't had a bad experience stepping forward. Was that a good story?
Amen.
Okay. All right. I have things that I brought with me that I'm going to offer in the foyer. I'm a writer. I have a book guaranteed to make you stronger. It weighs 1.4 pounds. This is my autobiography. I write as I talk. I'm a narrative writer, just like I tell my stories. And this is illustrated. It has pictures in it. I'm looking for one. Here, B-1 Bomber. Okay, so this has pictures in it. I think it has about 30 pictures in it. this is my whole story. The introduction is by the prosecutor who prosecuted me. This is a book that's meant to change lives. If you get anything from me, get this book. It changes lives. I've gotten so many. If you know people who are dealing with tragedy, if you know people who are dealing with kids who are having trouble, this is for young people to read. Anybody can read this book. And then I wrote a series called High on Adventure. I have High on Adventure 1 and 3. I ran out of 2. I'm self-publishing now. These were printed by publishing houses. I had 3 different publishing houses I was writing under. And I got the rights back, and I ran out of 2. And I can't afford yet to reprint 2. But I'm going to turn it into a Kindle book. And all these one day will be on Kindle, but I just got to catch up. Is there a diver in the house? Any scuba divers? I have this with me. This is my Expedition Diving Operations Handbook. It tells you how to run diving operations, particularly if you're going overseas. And then on DVDs, I have my story. This video by the Seventh-day Adventist Church.